Hey everybody, how's it going? And welcome back to RackFocus. I'm your host, Josh Hayes. We just got out of the podcast booth to talking with Newton Thomas Sigel, and we spent over an hour talking to Thomas about his career, and most specifically and recently, The Five Bloods. We always like to do a video segment afterwards, which is what this is. Now, if you don't know who Newton Thomas Sigel is, you could say he needs no introduction, but I feel like everybody deserves an introduction. So let's do a quick one.
See ghosts.
What happens to all of us, man?
Have you seen them too?
Yeah.
Dad come to you at night. Storm and Norm come to me down there every night. Now he talked to you like he talked to me.
Yeah, come on.
I don't think so.
Come on.
Fist up.
Get in there, David. Get in there. Put your fist up, David.
Come on.
Go on, you too, Van. Go ahead.
Fist up, man.
Come on, Paul.
Let's!
Okay. All right, here we go. So, five questions for you, sir. The first three questions are, the first three things are the same question, but for different movies. And that's going to be, what was your biggest technical challenge? So what was your biggest technical challenge on The Five Bloods, on Drive, etc.? Okay.
Oh boy. This has to be quick, huh?
No. It doesn't have to be fast. You don't have to think fast or any of that. No. So first up, and most topical and timely, because it's what we talked about for an hour on the podcast, The Five Bloods, this is Spike Lee's newest film. What was your biggest technical challenge on that?
I think the biggest technical challenge was accommodating, difficult locations with older actors. They're actually, the guys were in remarkably good shape, but Del Orlando, I used to go in the pool with him. He'd swim laps around me. But controlling really, harsh tropical light, but respecting it as well, because you don't want it to look all glossy and Hollywood like,
So you didn't want to take its character away, but you still wanted to be able to use it essentially.
Yeah, and I think also we talked about it earlier, but the going up like really steep terrain with the actors was difficult. And one of the very strong concepts that Spike had for the movie was this idea of these guys revisiting their memories, but as their present age. So they're not like, oh, I remember when I was young. It's like, I am revisiting, rethinking, reconsidering and reconceiving this experience that happened to me. And so I think it was a brilliant idea to use these older actors portraying themselves in their youth, but that's obviously made it more complex for how you accommodate those actors.
That's actually a good point, because for some of the audience, if you haven't seen The Five Bloods, you don't know is that that's a part of it. So, let's say Del Orlando is 63 or something. I don't know his age exactly. Del Orlando is 63 is playing himself 23 as well, but not with prosthetics and not doing what Scorsese did for The Irishman, where they digitally de-aged them, and the SF is just, yeah. He looks the same there as he looks when he's 25. You know what I mean? So it's kind of interesting. That must have been challenging, yeah, because I'm thinking about, Delroy Lindo, there's like action scenes or shootouts. So Delroy Lindo has to run full speed right next to a Chadwick Boseman, who's the only person who is the age of the younger person in that, because there's no older version of him. So that must have been challenging.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Okay, that's the first one. Same question, different movie, Bohemian Rhapsody. What was the most technically challenging part of working on Bohemian Rhapsody?
Probably the most technically difficult shot was, I conceived a shot that started over London and came across Wembley, down across the crowd, into a close-up of Freddie Mercury at the piano. And that was it wasn't too bad in its actual execution, but the planning of it and the preparation for it was very challenging and complicated. And then that was probably one of the biggest challenges. Bohemian Rhapsody had a few of it. You know, we had a number of concerts that we had to do on one stage within just a couple of days of shooting, because, you know, we didn't have the ability to, you know, shoot concerts for weeks and weeks. So being able to take a stage and reconfigure it and relight it literally within a matter of a couple hours so that you could present it as if it was a totally different concert. That was a challenge. And I think Live Aid was a challenge in so far as, you know, you're shooting for several days and you're trying to make it all be continuous in terms of its look and its feel. That was a challenge. In particular, because I wasn't allowed to sort of silk and green screen the whole area, which is what I had hoped to do, but I had to deal with it on a, you know, day in day out basis. That was tough.
Yeah, and I can only imagine the costs to have that many extras in a scene, and I guess it makes sense as to why they would flip it from concert one to concert two to concert three, just from a production standpoint.
Well, and that was another challenge, which is that we didn't have that many extras actually, and even when we did, we never had more than 900, and they didn't want to, you know, have those 900 extras there every day we were shooting. They only wanted it for like a couple of days, so it was like, okay, now rather than organizing our shooting schedule around the light, or organizing it around, performance, we had to organize our schedule around the extras. So it became, ideally, like for my money, I would have loved to have done the whole concert every day from different angles so that you could have had a continuity like they had when they did Live Aid, which was that, you know, it was only a 20-minute set, but it was toward the very end of the day. So you had this sort of very subtle gradation of light that was happening during the concert. So I would have loved to have, like, you know, done the beginning, each day. But that would have been, it works for the light, but it would have been very hard for the actors, because what it would have meant is that, you know, they were doing this song and then that song and then that song. And they kind of wanted to do, it was just easier for them to do one song a day because they could concentrate on the choreography of that song. Because they were, unlike the camera, which was purposely different from the BBC broadcast, the performance, especially Rami as Freddie Mercury, wanted to be very exact to the original performance. So he really replicated, with some flourishes of his own, but he really replicated Freddie's performance.
Okay. The absolutely critically acclaimed, one of my favorite movies, probably a top 25, Drive.
I think that I don't know if it was a technical or an aesthetic challenge, but one of the challenges was, it's a movie called Drive about a character who's called Driver because he has no name. And so we had a number of action sequences involving the car and driving. And one of the challenges, the big challenges, was how do we give each one of those its own character, its own personality? So, for instance, the opening, we decided that we were going to tell the whole story from inside the car. Drive-bys, no, you know, car-to-car stuff. It was all going to be with driver in the car. That was a solution. So each one of the car sequences, we tried to find a different personality to it. And that was a challenge because, you know, like most people at this point in their career, I've shot a plethora of cars and chase sequences and car crashes and car explosions and beauty shots. And there's only so many ways you can shoot a car. So to try to, you know, on a very tight, limited, we had no real second unit or anything like that, to try to do that in a limited budget and time was a real challenge.
I wanted to follow more on that, but I want to get the other two in because we know you have limited time and you got to get to the studio, especially before the studio inevitably closes down with COVID. So,
well, they're closing it down. It's this literally a facility that had 300 people will now have 10 today.
I mean, it's par for the course right now, but just to hear it out loud is frightening, especially for our industry. Okay, number two. If you were not a cinematographer, what would you have wanted to be if you could have chosen?
Well, you know, I my son is really, really into music. And I watch him play the guitar or play the drums. And I go, oh, man, I wish I could do that. You know, I did a movie with Katie Lang up in the Arctic Circle. And we were in Alaska, and I brought a guitar with me, and she said she was going to teach me how to play the guitar. And she taught me like two chords and then lost interest in me. And I was stuck and I just gave up. And it's one of my big regrets in life is I wish I could have kept playing.
It's too bad. I mean, because now during quarantine would be the perfect time for just to have a new hobby to try to learn how to do something, right?
Well, I don't think it was her job. It was my job to stick to it.
True. True. All right. Last one. I like to ask this about people who've worked on a variety of different films. So what's a project that you worked on that you feel like didn't get the recognition or maybe people just never heard about it because they didn't have a marketing budget or whatever, just along those lines, something that you worked on. And it doesn't have to be that like that what you did or didn't do on it, just that when it was a completed film that you were like, this is a fucking great movie. I wish this would have got the recognition that it deserved or something along those lines. Like that project you worked on that people don't know about well.
That's a really easy question for me to answer because after Three Kings, George Clooney asked me to do Confessions of a Dangerous Mind. And it was probably one of the best experiences of my life as a filmmaker, where it was his first film as a director. And we really prepped it to the point where we had every single shot planned out, which is what we actually shot. We finished a day early. It was a really wonderful creative collaboration and on an incredible script, you know, a very unique, singular project. And Harvey Weinstein was the producer on it, and George, I believe Steven Soderbergh had Final Cut. George was, you know, obviously he's a very powerful figure in Hollywood. You know, Harvey naturally wanted to completely recut his movie. George had the movie he wanted to make. And so Harvey buried the movie. You know, he literally sort of cut off his nose to spite his face. And the movie never got the distribution, let alone any kind of recognition. So that's one that to this day I feel bad about. Like I really wish that the film had been seen by more people than it has been seen by, because it's a very special, unique kind of movie. It was a year that I believe he had like two or three other movies that were, I think, Gangs of New York and Hours. He had other movies that were up for Academy Award potential. And that was all his focus was there. And George was like, you know, why don't you release Confessions next year? And he said, ah, no. Nah. And he released it, I think it was like on New Year's Eve or something. So it literally was done with, and, you know, it was Miramax at the time. Miramax was famous for its ability to take, you know, limited budget and smaller movies and really, really make them be part of the national conversation. And Harvey just buried it. Yeah, did nothing.
Well, I guess it worked. I think I'm pretty representative of the general audience, and I didn't know that film existed. So, but it gives me my next film to watch, at least based on what you said.
Go see Confessions of a Dangerous Mind.
Okay, well, that's that. Tom, thank you so much for taking the time to chat with us. We really appreciate it. Good luck on what's coming up next, whatever that is. Actually, you are, what is in production or what had just finished production is Cherry, right? Is that correct?
Cherry. It's a story directed by the Russo brothers with Tom Holland, who, yeah, I will say is phenomenal. I mean, it's an absolutely breathtaking performance. So, yeah, I'm very excited about that.
And also want to wish you luck on the hardly any work to be done during COVID insanity that it is going, all of us video producers are going through right now.
Well, thank you. Stay healthy, stay happy, and we'll see you on the other side.